Now, most of you are familiar with the fictional boogeyman, Slenderman, the tall, thin, and faceless creature that stalks and snatches people in the dark, but we all know that he's not real, right? But you will never believe the horrifying things two girls did when they thought that Slenderman was real. Let's dive in. Their friendship started in fourth grade. Payton Leutner felt sorry for the quiet, lonely girl who was always sitting by herself in the cafeteria. Everyone deserves at least one friend, Payton thought, as she approached Morgan Geyser. That's just how Payton was, always thinking about other people. She was sweet, kind, and caring, and already had lots of friends. But when she noticed that Morgan was having a difficult time making friends, she took it upon herself to be Morgan's friend. The two girls immediately hit it off, and they soon became the best of friends. They hung out together, had sleepovers, and did all the normal things that girls their age did. Morgan turned out to be quite a fun person to be around. She was always laughing and making jokes, and even gave Payton a sweet nickname, Bella. For the next 2 years, the two girls were inseparable and did basically everything together. But when they were in sixth grade, a new girl, Anissa Wire, entered the picture. Anissa lived in the same apartment complex as Morgan, and the two became friends. And that's when things started taking a dark turn. Anissa and Morgan soon found out they had a lot more in common, and so they started pushing Payton to the side. They also had discovered the video game Slender Man and had become obsessed with it. They would talk of nothing else but the fictional monster who they believed was actually real. Payton was not so much into the game and found the character weird and scary, but since she didn't want to disappoint her friends, she just played along. The two girls' obsession for Slender Man went on for a while, and they started becoming paranoid, saying that Slender Man was coming for them. This made Payton really uncomfortable, and at some point, she asked her mom if Slender Man was real, and she was super relieved when she was told he was not. In May 2014, Morgan's 12th birthday had rolled around, and the girls were super excited about the slumber party at Morgan's house. They started off with skating at a local skating rink, and then had some pizza and frozen yogurt. Everything was going well, and nothing seemed out of place.
Laid up in Morgan's bedroom, ran up and down the stairs, giggling and laughing, and I mean, it was just a normal night.
But there was nothing normal about what Morgan and Anissa were planning. The next morning, the girls woke up very early and decided to go to the park. But when they got there, Anissa suggested that they take a walk to the woods and play hide and seek.
I wanted to go on a walk, and I didn't think much of it. It's just a walk. It's in Waukesha. Like, what bad stuff happens in Waukesha, Wisconsin?
So Payton innocently followed her two friends to the woods, and when Anissa asked her to lie on the ground, she did. And that's when everything changed.
Anissa told me to lie on the ground and, like, cover myself in, like, sticks and leaves and stuff, but it was really just a trick.
As soon as she got down, Morgan pounced at Payton and started attacking her with a kitchen blade. At first, Payton was in shock. She didn't know how to react. I mean, these were her friends. Why would they hurt her? The piercing pain from the blade and the betrayal were just too much. She screamed in agony, begging Morgan to stop, but Morgan just carried on. When she finally stopped, Payton tried to get up, but Anissa pushed her down, telling her to lay still because the blood would come out slower. The two girls then left her there, saying they were going to get help, but they never did. Payton was bleeding and badly wounded, but she knew she had to survive, and the only way to do that was to get out in the open where someone could find her.
I got up and then just walked until I hit a patch of grass where I could lay down.
Fortunately, a cyclist happened to be riding by and saw Payton lying on the grass with blood all over her clothes. He called 911 and offered her some water.
She's awake.
Is there any bleeding going on?
Her clothing has got blood on it.
When the police and the paramedics arrived, they were shocked at the critical state that Payton was in. But she could still talk, and she told them that her friends had done that to her. Payton was then rushed to the hospital where her distraught mother found her as she was about to go into surgery.
I said, "You're gonna be okay. It's gonna be fine." But I could see that she was covered. Her arms and her legs and her abdomen, they were covered in stab wounds.
Payton had been stabbed 19 times, and two of those strikes had hit major organs, including her liver, and one had almost gone through her heart and had missed a major artery by a whisker. In fact, the doctor said that if a blade had gone just a little further, Payton would not have lived. While Payton was fighting for her life, her two assailants were off on a crazy mission to find the house where Slender Man supposedly lived. By the time the police caught up with them, they had walked 5 hours cars and were almost out of the city. They still had on the bloody clothes they wore that morning, and the police found the knife that they used in their bag. But the weirdest thing was that they seemed unbothered by the fact that they had almost taken someone's life. In fact, when they were taken in for questioning, Morgan was even dancing in the interrogation room, acting like this was a normal day in the playground. They would later confess they had been planning the attack for months, and they did it for Slender Man. They told detectives that they had planned to harm Payton in her sleep during the slumber party, but that they changed their minds. The second plan involved taking Payton to the park and ambushing her in the bathroom because they wanted a place where her blood would drain. This also did not work out, and so they finally settled for the woods. At one point during the interrogation, Morgan asked about Payton, referring to her as Bella, asking if she was dead, and her reaction when she heard that Payton was in the hospital was just cold. Like, she didn't care whether Payton lived or died.
Is she dead?
I don't know. If you
want
to take her to the hospital.
What? I was just wondering.
Anissa told investigators that though she felt guilty about what they did to Payton, she believed it was necessary, saying that they wanted to please Slender Man. Apparently, they believed that taking someone's life made them worthy to be Slender Man's servants. She also pointed a finger at Morgan, saying that she was the one who came up with the idea to hurt Payton. Morgan, on the other hand, said Anissa had told her that they had to do it so that Slender Man spared their family.
Told me we had to.
Why?
Because she said that he'd kill our family.
When asked if she felt bad about hurting Payton, she gave a weird reply saying that she felt no remorse and that she chose to live without regrets.
Did you feel bad? They just stabbed one of your best friends.
I thought about it, but then I decided that remorse will get me nowhere. It's easier to live without regrets.
Despite their young age, the two girls were charged in adult courts with first-degree attempted homicide. But before they could start trial, the girls were diagnosed with several types of mental disorders. Morgan was found to have early onset schizophrenia and a psychotic spectrum disorder, which made her prone to delusions. Schizophrenia is a serious mental disorder that makes it hard for a person to differentiate between reality and something from their imagination. Though the condition is treatable, it cannot be cured, and most have to stay on medication for the rest of their lives. Nisa was diagnosed with post-traumatic stress disorder, major depression, and a personality disorder. She later pleaded guilty to a lesser charge of being an accessory, but was found not guilty for reason of insanity. She was sent to a mental institution for a maximum of 25 years, with the first 3 years being served in solitary confinement. Since Morgan was the one who did the actual crime, she agreed to plead guilty to the first charge of attempted homicide. But just like Anissa, she was also found not guilty on grounds of insanity. She was sent to a mental institution for 40 years or more, depending on her psychiatric evaluation. It took a long time for Payton to recover from the ordeal. In one interview in 2019, she said that she was so scared after the incident that she slept with her mom for a while so that she wouldn't be alone at night. As you can imagine, she also developed some serious trust issues and found it hard to make friends. But despite all these, Payton is doing her best to move on with her life and put that incident behind her. She is now in college pursuing a career in the medical field, which she said was inspired by the ordeal. While Morgan is still in a mental institution, Anissa got an early release in July 2021 after she proved that she had gone through all the necessary treatment and that she was no longer a threat to herself and those around her. However, she will remain under state supervision until the age of 37. This is so far the craziest case that I have ever done. This incident actually inspired the documentary Beware the Slender Man, which was featured on HBO in 2017. The creator of the Slender Man character, Eric Newsden, even came forward to apologize to the families of those affected by the incident. While I can say that I'm happy that Payton survived, it's scary to imagine that there are a lot of people out there with undiagnosed mental illnesses, and one small thing might one day trigger them. That's the end of our video today. What do you think about this case? Let me know your thoughts down in the comment section.